But it's whether, do I believe God can do it? And God says, if you believe, then you can stand before me any day. Glory to God. So what? You have no righteousness, Williams. You don't worry about it. God says, I'm going to just give it to you. Because you believe what I said. Hallelujah. Now this is where the rubber and the road meets. Can you believe? This is where the rubber and the road meets for you breaking out to your breakthrough. Is can you ask, whatsoever thing you ask, whatever thing you desire, whatever thing you want in prayer, can you believe? And that's all God wants. Can you believe? I do. Hallelujah. When we start the Oklahoma State check coming in the mail, $320 toward bills. Bills is $1,000, the $320 went to it. That thing don't even get close to taking care of you. Delivering you. I don't know what to check. Yes, $320? $32? Straight to the house of the Lord. Come what may. Come what may. Abraham, hold that knife. Don't you kill that kid. Says, now Abraham, I know you are a friend of mine. I know you believe me. Because you took that one thing that you wanted so bad and put it on the altar, and I asked you to do it. I tested you with it, and you was going to sacrifice it just in obedience. Abraham, hold your hand. You're really blessed. You're my friend. Now, that's what we want to do is say, when can I become a friend of God? The Bible answers, when you start believing him. When you start working in obedience. Start walking in obedience. Come what may. Ooh, they call it, in the business I'm in, drawing your line. This is my moment. I ain't going back. Oh, I wish I had maybe 10 of these. Glory to God. All right, look at verse 18 of that fifth chapter. In the same day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham, saying, until thy seed have I given this land, until thy seed have I given this land, from the river Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates, the Kentites, the Kenzites, and the Anamites, Hittites, Perizzites, Amorites, Canaanites, Gergesites, Jebusites. Giving you all this. The amazing thing is that once blessings start, they just seem to just overrun you. They seem to just overtake you. Once you break through, and then the devil, see, he's pressing you, trying to get you to listen to all the other sounds in the world or what have you, and so that you can't break through. By the time that we're going through, the Bible says, come to the throne so you can find, you can obtain mercy. So that the bad stuff, just come to the throne and the God will protect. I'll be your shield, he says. See, God knows what we're going through. He knows what you, he knew that Jabez has a sorry life. His mother even put that name on him, sorry. Sorry. Nothing good here. But Jabez says, oh, but oh, if you would just bless me. Enlarge my borders. And keep evil away from me. Then he says, I know I have it then. So we have to be brave enough and step up to the plate and say, Lord, that's me. That's me. Praise God. All right, praise God. Look at Psalms 32, 1 and 2, if you will, please. I know Romans 8 says something to this. There's therefore now no condemnation to them that are were in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but out of the spirit. So we have to get the devil going to beat beat you up on your mind and say that you're not worthy for a blessed life. You're not worthy of a breakthrough. You're not worthy of the things that God will have for you. That's what the devil was saying. But even David recognized something way back in days of old. He says, I think if someone got Psalms 32 and 1, can you go ahead and shout it out if you would have watched it? Anybody?
Blessed is he whose transgressions is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord imputes not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile.
Woo! Blessed is the man whose what? Transgression is given, is forgiven, whose sin is what? Covered. Glory to God. You don't come out to the prayer meeting trying to cover up your stuff. God's already, he's covering you up. It's like he did Aaron. Aaron, you're just a man, you're going to die, but you're my priest. Put on these garments and cover yourself up. So now what does the believer have to do? Just cover yourself up and say, God, cover me with your righteousness. I'm coming in. I'm coming in. We're going to do business. And this is what David finds out. Blesses that man. And then he says in verse 5, I acknowledge my sin. My iniquity have I not hid. I said I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Thou forgivest my iniquity, forgivest the iniquity of my sin. Then it says, verse 6, for this shall everyone that is godly pray unto thee at a time when you can be found. Now, if there's anything that earthquake did, it's just kind of letting you know that there's going to be a time. If you're going to be getting in front of God, I think you should be doing on that about right now.
Amen.
Glory to God. If you're going to do business with God, I would say it's a good time to start about like yesterday.
Yes.
Glory to God. Glory to God. Surely in the flood, surely in turmoil, in floods of great waters, they should not come nigh me. Thou art my what? Hide in place. Thou shalt preserve me from trouble. Thou shalt compass me about with songs of deliverance. See, you ought to have more than one song. The Lord saved my life when I was sick over here, Sister Denise. Got another song for you to sing. Sister Irene, the Lord healed my arm, whatever it was the Lord. Songs of deliverance. Make known his deeds to the people. Songs. You don't make this stuff up. You sing about what has really happened. I was sick. Now I'm well. I was poor. Now I'm rich. Now I'm blessed. Songs of deliverance. Glory to God. But once you stay away, you're just boxing yourself in. Mercy can't get to you. Grace can't find you because you're not coming to the throne. Verse 7, thou art my hiding place. Thou shalt preserve me. Verse 8, I will trust. I mean, I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way that you should go. Your destiny is with God. Your destiny is with God. Verse 11, let's look at that. It says, be glad in the Lord and rejoice, ye righteous, and shout for joy, all ye the upright in heart. You can't lose. You can't lose. Rejoice in the Lord. You're righteous. Shout for joy because God's defending you. He's making a way for you. But you have to step up to a plate and you got to say, Lord, here's my earnest desire. I tell you, if you put it on the, just come to God and put it down on the altar and say, God, I'm tired of being broke and poor and sick and ugly and stupid. I'm tired of all of that. I want sophistication. I want good stuff. I want to walk on the high places of the earth. Glory to God. I want to declare that you are my God. Look what the Lord has done.
Amen.
Glory to God. And You can see in the Bible says no one listens to a broke, poor, ugly, sick, crazy, stupid person. No one takes his advice. But when you can say to a new believer, a new convert, and says, look, I was there where you were, but the Lord brought me out. I was sick and the Lord healed me. I was brokenhearted and the Lord delivered me. Hallelujah. But who's that story to go to? One to the other. Strength to strength. Every one of them are praying before the Lord. This is what the Lord has done. Glory to God. Glory to God. Woo, praise God. So let's go back to the book of Hebrews, 5th chapter, verse 4. I'm going to close out there. It says, Hebrews 5th chapter, verse 4, no man take this honor unto himself, but he that is called of God, like Aaron was. So also Christ glorified not himself to be made a high priest, but he that said unto him, thou art my son, today have I begotten thee. And he said also in another place, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. That's us. Who in the days of his flesh, this is Jesus now, in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard, and that he feared. And this is Jesus as he was on this earth. He offered up, there was a time when he cried and was very, very scared of death. But he knew he had to pass that way. But it was not a natural thing. It was not something he was familiar with. God is the God of life. The Bible says, I come that you might have it and have it more abundantly. So death was not something he knew that territory very well. And he didn't want to deal with it. But the Bible says he offered up prayers and crying and tears. Though he were his son, he was God's son, yet learned he obedience by what he suffered. Being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. Called of God. Jesus, called of God, a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. See, this priest is that he's praying. He gives intercessions. And we know that Jesus is at the right hand of the Father making intercessions for you and I. That's his work right now. That's his work. So if you come to that throne and say, I know I'm giving my all and my priesthood, but I know there's another high priest that's working to help me out and me even push it forward. That's Jesus praying for you. Or if you knew Jesus was praying for you day and night, all day long, all the time, you'll have a different attitude about stuff. You'll see stuff a little bit different. You wouldn't surrender so easily to the dictates of sin. You wouldn't bow down to sickness so quick. You just wouldn't do it because you say, I got Jesus praying for me. I have a great high priest. Now the Bible says in verse 11, of whom we have many things to say. Says we have many things to say, but he says, I can't say them to you now because you ain't got the ear to hear. Mm-hmm. That was another time that Jesus said that. It's when he was speaking of the Holy Ghost. And that's what he's saying, that you're not spiritually alive enough to hear. But I can tell you about your priesthood and about your great high priest. It's too spiritual for you. Now, the thing about grace to me is that it catches me by surprise. I didn't know God was going to open up that door like that. Grace just catches you off guard. Look at that. Ooh, that was the Lord. What's going on? It's just grace moving for you. working for you. So, here's what he says here. I'm going to finish up here. Oh yeah, verse 18 of chapter 6. Let's go with verse 17. Wherein God willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath. That by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge, lay hold upon the hope that is set before us, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, which enter into within the veil, whether the forerunner for us entered, who entered on our behalf in intercession, Jesus, made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And the priesthood, Aaron's family, when God made promise to Israel that I'm taking you to all these lands, the priesthood, they had to do no labor. They didn't have to do any battles. It was just all open for them to have. God took care of his priesthood. Now this is what I'm telling you. It says over there that you are a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Now it was for Adam to work and sweat and worry by the sweat of his brow as to how he was going to make it. But you would worry too much about how I'm going to make it. How am I going to pay my bills? How am I going to get from this week to next week? The priesthood didn't have that kind of worry. God ordained it that things just rolled to them. Special people. Now you can declare your own lot. Where am I in the family of God? Where am I of the family of men on the earth? Am I one that worry and stress out and sweat about and get all tied up and in knots worrying about how I'm going to make it? Or am I a priest? And do I have a time of prayer where I'm at the altar? Where I'm making intercessions? The devil will say, you're too busy. You got to go work that third job. You got to sit down at that table and try to figure out how to pay these bills. You got to do this, you got to do that. You can't make it to the throne. I mean, you can't approach the throne. You're too busy. But we have to say, no, I'm a priest. That's my place. My provisions are taken care of. The Bible says, cast all your cares upon him, for he does what? Care for you. But if you're too busy worrying about the downside of life and the things of life, you'll never step into your priesthood. But if you step into your priesthood, you'll be blessed. You'll be covered. You'll be wearing the gold. Oh, I can just go on and on and on. But the Bible says, you're not ready to hear. It takes some spiritual insight, revelation knowledge. Open it up to you what is yours already. The Levites, I mean, Aaron's family, they didn't hustle for nothing. It was already theirs. It was given to them provision. God will give you all this stuff, all this land. And everybody else had to go in and do battle and fight everything, but the priests, they hung back. They had a special place for you. Hallelujah. So how many know that you can't do it by yourself? It's going to be those problems, the things of life, it's going to be there. The problem is that, the answer is that, are you going to break through and say, God, just bless me? That's an attitude to have. God, just bless me. Just enlarge my borders. I'm going to pray for brother or sister, whoever. I'm going to pray back intercessions. My issues, my deals, they're out there, they're all that stuff. But God, I'm coming to your throne, and in front of your throne, in your presence, I get mercy. I'd rather go get mercy any day than worry about PSO. Or the call out, or whatever, the call on places. I would go get mercy any day. I know every time I'm in prayer, in an atmosphere of prayer, I'm getting mercy. Stuff that you're getting what you don't deserve. You're getting good. You're getting blessed. You didn't merit it. It just happens. It's part of the promises of God. Glory to God. And you stay away, and life's too busy, gas costs too much, $3 a gallon. Oh man, I can't cross town for you forsake your what? Own mercy. He that observes lying vanities does what? Forsake his own mercy. Oh boy, I feel like I need to preach now. It's time to go home. Hallelujah. But your mercy is there for you if you want it. If you want God to show up, just show up. Draw nigh, he'll do what? Draw nigh to you. Let's stand, let's have a prayer.